Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Art of Communication, How to Be Authentic, Lead Others, and Create Strong Connections by Judy Apps, narrated by Teri Schnaubelt. Intelligence is of two kinds. Jalal ad-Din Muhammad Rumi, Persia, 1207 to 1273. We should take care not to make the intellect our god. It has, of course, powerful muscles, but no personality. It cannot lead, it can only serve, and it is not fastidious in its choice of a leader. Albert Einstein, born in Germany, 1879 to 1955. It is not rational to assume, without evidence, that rationality can disclose everything about the world, just because it can disclose some things. Our intuition in favor of rationality, where we are inclined to use it, is just that, an intuition. Reason is founded in intuition and ends in intuition, like a pair of massive bookends. Ian McGilchrist, Britain, 1953. Part 1. Introduction. Amazing Conversations. Prologue. Just another conversation. Happy the moment when we are sitting here, you and I, with two forms and with two figures, but with one soul, you and I. Rumi. Some conversations give you a buzz of connection that surprises and delights. In such conversations, time stands still, and the boundaries between you collapse, allowing something new and exciting to emerge. But how can you encourage such connections to happen more often when conversation is by nature spontaneous and unpredictable? The little cabin we booked to rent in Shropshire was next door to an old house containing a restaurant that was shut at present. The owner, Elizabeth, came out to meet us and briefly explained that her husband wasn't available to open the restaurant during our stay, as he was currently ill. She showed us around our cabin, invited us to contact her if we needed anything, and then withdrew. Later, as we strolled out to explore, we paused by display shelves in the front garden containing a variety of interesting jams and pickles and unusual garden plants for sale, set up by our host. We didn't see Elizabeth again until the morning of our departure a few days later, when she emerged from the house to wish us goodbye. As we said our thanks and farewells, we quietly asked her about her husband, and she explained that, after a few years of ups and downs with cancer, his condition was now terminal and the time remaining probably short. As we listened, she told us about his work as a restaurant chef, their life in other cities, and some of the challenges of running things on her own now. We admired her garden, produce, and plants, and commented on the variety of birds that were attracted by the food she put out in feeders. Encouraged by our interest, she told us about her excitement a couple of days before, when, in the early dawn, she had witnessed 5 nuthatch fledglings leave the nest. Time was suspended for a few moments, and I felt physically the frisson of our connection. What was it? A short, inconclusive conversation with a stranger. Yet I took much more from our conversation than some sad facts and some happier ones. It felt as if we had shared for a moment a larger theme of life. Such words are perhaps too abstract and fail to recognize how real the exchange felt. To each of us, I think. The truth lay in some in-betweenness, and it touched us. What is the art of communication? I'm aware of so many oddities in communication. Why, for instance, did someone thank me for helping them make the best decision of their life on an occasion when I'd offered neither advice nor sympathetic words? And why did a friend come out with a form of words not even strictly connected with our conversation that unblocked a stuck feeling I'd had for a long time? Why did I feel a beautiful shiver of connection with someone during a conversation that, superficially, had merely been about the best time to visit Crete? And why did I get goosebumps in the silences between words in a conversation with someone? Maybe you recognize that frisson of something shared. I have encountered it at different times in my life. Several years ago, on a course, chatting with a fellow participant for the first time, something about her words and attitude touched a chord, so that I felt I had known her for a long time, and I went home buzzing with the energy of the encounter. I had the feeling sometimes also as a child when my mother spoke to me about this and that at bedtime. I recall a tingling feeling of timeless pleasure and of not wanting the moment to end. There have been other times when someone has spoken to me of something personal to them, and I've known that no response is needed, just my listening. What they are speaking about doesn't even have to be anything particular. It's sufficient that they are absorbed by it, and I am connected to them in their absorption, inside their space. Frisson of connection. Before we go further, recall for a moment times when you felt a special connection when you communicated with someone. Remember a time when you had a conversation that felt especially enjoyable or remarkable. Maybe it felt more real, more three-dimensional somehow than normal encounters. Or maybe an ordinary conversation miraculously lifted off to another plane, and it was as if a veil had lifted between you. You felt a thrill of pleasure, like waves of energy running all over your skin, and you felt intensely alive. Spend a moment or two remembering the occasion and capture the feeling you had at the time. Ask yourself, what gave you pleasure? What made it exceptional? Accept whatever answers pop up in your mind. In such conversations, you are met in your soft center, that beautiful, timeless part of you. From time to time, through such communication where two people draw close, something creative is generated, some idea, some insight, some glimpse of new wisdom or truth. You may find my opening story inconclusive, even trivial, and a long way from what you've understood about communication, particularly business communication. A common received view is that communication is about having opinions, knowing what you want, and getting your message across. But there's a huge gap between people hearing what you say, even appreciating aspects of it, and their connecting with you, let alone acting on what you say or changing their thinking or attitude because of it. Most talk, in meetings, the boardroom, presentations, conferences, doesn't cross that gap, however fluent your language, firm your voice, and confident your physiology. Clearly, conversation has unexplored depths that are not covered in simple manuals on small talk or conversational skills. For just as surely, my most productive conversations have been capable of breaking any of the usual rules of conversation, such as clarity of purpose, sharing of time, use of questions to elicit information, avoidance of silence, focus on meaning, and so on. Those who inspire and kindle new thinking are doing something different, fundamentally different. Genuine communication is about crossing that gap. We all struggle with communication at times. Do you sometimes find yourself in a situation where you'd like to say something but don't know what to say? Or you know what you want to say but can't find the right opportunity to say it? Have you chatted to someone, wanting to connect with them, but realized you weren't really communicating with each other at all? When you examine communication, you might be struck by the artificiality and sheer awkwardness of many interactions, even between people who are accomplished in the art of conversation. The truth is that many interactions are less than authentic, as people tend to operate from habitual positions, largely beyond conscious awareness, to fit in, people please or avoid embarrassment, look knowledgeable, be admired, or seize business advantage. In the final chapters of my last book, The Art of Conversation, I began to explore some of the ways we can connect more deeply and fruitfully with each other. But communicating at that level doesn't naturally result from increased competence. We talk about communication as if it's a skill you can acquire step by step, and to an extent, that is true. There is much you can learn that will make your conversations more fluent and satisfying. But there is the uncomfortable truth that, however much you may hone your skills as a communicator, No matter how interesting your facts, however fascinating your stories, even how well you share the conversation, deeper, more meaningful communication does not naturally follow on from conversational competence. It requires something rather different. The risks of spontaneity. The first and major challenge of conversation is that it's essentially a spontaneous activity, an everyday improvisation. At times we can prepare, but we can't safely predict when we're going to have a conversation or how it's going to pan out. In conversation, there's no getting away from it. We have to think and speak on the hoof. For many people, speaking freely represents a risky enterprise. Not only might the other person take something the wrong way, but you might also say something you might regret, or embarrass yourself by talking garrulously or having absolutely nothing to say. Surrounded as we are by spin, sound bites, Twitter, and Facebook, spontaneity can feel downright dangerous. Today, a trivial, unconsidered remark can go viral in minutes, spiraling out of control in the glare of digital publicity. The actor Benedict Cumberbatch innocently used an outdated word to describe actors of color and was pilloried for it. The novelist Hilary Mantel was hit with death threats after comparing the Duchess of Cambridge's situation to that of a shop window mannequin in a thoroughly sympathetic article. Good reason to be cautious, you might think. So, most people exert whatever control they can, ever more so in the current environment. Does such control work? It does, but only to a limited degree. Many recognize control for what it is and find it limited and tedious. Even leaving out fake news, there is a widespread mistrust of words, especially words spoken powerfully. We no longer believe the tightly scripted speech and want something less formulaic and more energizing than the talk of repetitive politicians, unnuanced interviewers, and relentlessly jolly media conversationalists. Popularity of the unpredictable. Among the public, there is an appetite for more genuine communication that is partially fed by reality television programs. Never has there been such curiosity to know the private lives and quirks of personalities in the media, or to be a fly on the wall in the lives of ordinary people. It was surely this eagerness in the face of television's increasing predictability that spawned the rush of real-life programs from the late 1990s onwards. Big Brother, Strictly Come Dancing, The Apprentice, The Great British Bake Off, The X Factor, I'm a Celebrity, Love Island, and other programs came along to feed our appetite for the unexpected, showing ordinary people or the semi-famous being challenged in various situations and often caught with their defenses down. Admittedly, the footage is stage-managed for broadcast, but it still gives the audience many pleasurable, intimate glimpses of unplanned moments. Live shows offer the thrill of the unexpected and energize audiences with the anticipation of disaster. Fly-on-the-wall documentaries capture the misdemeanors and blunders of real life. Compilations of amateur clips of domestic disaster or embarrassment remain popular. The bride falls over, a child does a trick and comes to grief, people fall unsuspecting into water. Wildlife program makers discovered the popularity of how it's done behind-the-scenes filming and include real-life difficulties and disasters encountered during the shooting. The style of the reality program has leaked into politics, too, and the politician who seems the most real or merely the most unpredictable is often the one that catches the popular vote by feeding this compulsion to be surprised and shocked. In popular entertainment, there's no comedian as popular as the one who risks spontaneity. Robin Williams, for example, had such a talent for improvising that for some parts of his films, the script would read, "Robin will do his stuff here." Billy Connolly sounds surprised and delighted sometimes by his own ad-libbing. It's such a winning style that other successful comedians, such as Michael McIntyre, hone their tried-and-tested material to make it sound as if what they're about to say has just occurred to them that very minute. Audiences love especially the unpredictability of comedians who can't resist laughing at their own gags. Dudley Moore and Peter Cook often used to break down in laughter during their sketches, to the delight of their audiences. You'll find at least 500,000 viewings on YouTube of the occasion when normally serious newsreader Charlotte Green got an impossible fit of the giggles while introducing an item about the first recording of a human voice. She even received a letter from Prince Charles thanking her for causing tears to roll down his cheeks. Stakes too high. Most of us love to watch the unpredictable on screen, but whatever the reason, when it comes to our own endeavors in real life, the majority fall back on control. The stakes just feel too high. Conversations that aren't real. I used to see an old work friend for a cup of tea and a chat every month or so. Gradually, I began to enjoy our meetings less, though I wasn't quite sure why. Was it when I became aware that she talked about everything except herself? Or was it when I noticed that her responses to whatever I asked had a generalized pleasantness that I found bland and boring? I began to want to say something outrageous to provoke a more extreme reaction, though I never did. Then, months later, she informed me one day, with some embarrassment, that her wealthy husband had bought a luxury property elsewhere and was no longer living with her. Much later, she hinted that an acrimonious breakdown had been brewing for months. Feeling vulnerable, she'd been unable to talk about it. No wonder our conversations hadn't seemed real. I wished I had known at that time how to reach her. When threatened, and I suppose my friend was afraid of exposure or just lacked the words to explain her situation, most people fall back on the predictable. We may be entertained at times by their conversation, we may be offered facts, conversation may flow, but none of that brings the conversation alive or gives either party satisfaction. In the absence of openness, we miss genuine connection, the very qualities that make communication valuable and enjoyable. In an age when many, especially in public life, have mastered the social skills for talking about anything and everything at the drop of a hat, it's easy to think that we've all become too good at it. Goodness, we hear enough conversations around us. But when all they do is follow stock procedures, the interchanges end up predictable or contrived and words lose their potency. It's not the way to more meaningful communication. Secret of whole-mind conversation. So how do we approach communication if not through control? From time to time, you may meet someone who has the ability to say the perfect thing at the appropriate moment. They come up with original insights, spark connections that galvanize others, and offer words of comfort at the right time. Their communication opens people to each other in ways that seem miraculous. Talking to Lloyd was like talking to myself, only more honest, says Cody of her friend and lover in Barbara Kingsolver's Animal Dreams. Their conversations may make the hairs at the back of your neck stand up or create a dopamine rush with their promise of future possibility. Some conversations have even changed history. If you want some of this magic, then you have to look beyond conversational fluency and operate from a more intuitive place, radically different from the conscious or habitual intelligence normally employed in conversation. It's a place where being counts more than external skills, where treading lightly matters more than expertise, and where opening the heart is more important than critical evaluation. It's a step change. In this new world, few of the usual rules apply, and success sits very close to failure. But the rewards, when they come, are rich. The question is, how might you too call on this deeper intuition beyond conscious cleverness or accumulated knowledge when you interact with people? You have to be ready for the unpredictable and the unexpected. No amount of swatting to become more articulate, better at debate, or more informed, no accumulation of funds or better stories, or even a more friendly manner or persuasive voice is going to grant you success. You have to be prepared for a kind of learning that's surprising, that will show you yourself in the raw, question your relationships with others, and focus on being rather than doing. As a first step, you have to contemplate a loosening of attachment to preconceptions, step-by-step progress towards conclusions, and excessive future and past thinking. Just as the mathematics student suddenly discovers that advanced maths has as much to do with intuition as calculation, So the advanced communicator discovers that success depends as much on inner shifts and warmth of heart as on rational intelligence and social competence. The rational conscious mind, which mostly utilizes the left hemisphere of the brain, tends to proceed from step to step with focused attention to detail. But deeper communication makes creative use of the more holistic right brain, with its sustained, wide-angled alertness that can process information all of a piece without conscious focus on component parts. It's prompted by the immediate and doesn't fall back on well-worn wisdom and knowledge. And it tends to do this quickly, much faster than conscious thought. Using your whole mind, left and right brain, enables you to trust your intuition and creativity and brings you closer to people. Fresh discoveries about the roles of the different hemispheres of the brain enable us to understand the underlying science for the first time. In this book, we're going to look at the characteristics of this deeper conversation, as well as certain traits that masquerade as such. You'll discover how to make greater use of your deeper, intelligent mind, a mind that is far more intuitive and creative than you could imagine. Part 2. Opting for Control. Control Rules. We are like bowls on the surface of the water. The direction a bowl moves is controlled not by the bowl, but by the water. Rumi. There's always a tendency to control communication to avoid unwelcome surprises. Most people steer their conversation with habitual instructions to the brain, and these affect everything they say, mostly beyond self-awareness. With such agendas in place, stemming mainly from fear, they fail to truly show up when they encounter other people. The first step toward more authentic communication is to look at control. There's a strong instinct to control our environment and plan what to say and how to say it. Control is pervasive and entrenched in our culture. The all-favored modus operandi in politics, leadership, management, and every aspect of our lives. Much conversation today, whether social discourse, political interview, or media chat, is, in fact, highly measured and predictable. Unsurprising, as we've seen, when social media lurks ever ready to spread a thoughtless comment globally and create havoc. Some protect themselves by sticking blandly in social mode. They articulate correct social responses, stay within strict boundaries, and parrot received opinions while revealing nothing significant about themselves. Some act like machines and speak entirely without emotion. Others play games of charm and other manipulation, pretend insouciance or respond in a particular personality or role. At the same time, many are inhibited by self-consciousness, lack of self-esteem, fear, and other overriding emotions. They guard their words, hide their feelings, and prepare in meticulous detail for significant occasions such as interviews, speeches, and presentations. In the workplace, every effort is made to avoid surprises. People are analyzed and assessed. Human traits are measured and evaluated. Everything possible is done to create certainty and guarantee expected results. Much has been written and spoken about how to maintain better control of events and people. Gradually, we have devised procedures that minimize surprise so that we know what to do for almost every eventuality. We find control everywhere, even disguised as freedom and spontaneity. Some people, especially in public life, play the role of spontaneity with an easy, unconstrained manner that disguises hard-headed calculation beneath the surface. General bonhomie can act as a strong self-defense, never allowing the real person to emerge and making anything but superficial connection unlikely. Most common of all is the tendency to speak with a filter permanently in place, controlling what is said. For example, conversation with the aim of showing oneself in a good light, winning points, obtaining personal advantage, or pleasing people. The conversation can appear relaxed, but the impression is skin deep. Some powerful populist politicians come into this category. Control shows up too as habits of conversation that we are no longer capable of noticing in ourselves. Maybe we are negative and complain a lot, or have the tendency to blame others. Maybe we display constant, facile positivity in the face of good sense. Perhaps we instinctively say no to everything and miss opportunities. Such behaviors become our defaults, and they prevent us from living our desires or even asking ourselves whether we have desires at all. This can prevent anything new from surfacing in our lives, and it can get in the way of connection with other people. What is control? What does control consist of? In the simplest terms, it's left-brain thinking, where rationality with its linear processes, coherent systems, and concepts is promoted, while emotion and intuition are consigned to minor roles. With control, decisions are taken consciously, using the evaluating, analyzing parts of the brain. Evidence is accumulated, examined, and dissected. The method concentrates on building up facts and getting the details right, then abstracting and categorizing. We have arrived at a point in history where the left brain rules in business, politics, and public life. And indeed, in every sphere of our lives, we operate by more and more rules and increasing surveillance, accompanied by assurances that it's for our safety and general well-being. But we're missing out. There is a sense that the freedom and wonder of life is getting lost, and that it's not a small loss, but is changing us as human beings into something less attractive, less adaptable, and less inventive and creative. Control certainly rules in the realm of communication. Reflect on how seldom, with a very few notable exceptions, public statements today surprise us. Spin and sound bites threaten to drown out debate. Much talking on radio and television, even the news, is delivered by means of adversarial interviews, micromanaged in tight time slots by producers, while politicians and business leaders play the game of answering questions with prepared slogans to ensure predictable outcomes. Well-versed politicians, scripted interviews, party lines, stock answers, and stock emotions have become the common currency. Switch on the television, and all too often you are greeted by an over-energetic, smiling, and laughing face that neither energizes nor projects happiness, or a bland face that reacts to neither charm nor insult. It's make-believe, robotic even, a mask of plasticine smugness, as Russell Brand once referred to the expression of a typical politician. There are notable exceptions, but as we shall see, control agendas play a big part here too. Being thoroughly prepared. Going through my father's possessions after he died, I discovered a tightly folded piece of paper in the inside pocket of his old dinner jacket, containing minutely written instructions for the execution of various dance moves. The waltz, quickstep, foxtrot, samba, and tango were all included. He came prepared. Yet, when did he imagine he might do his final swatting by tucking this information into a pocket of his dinner jacket? On a quick visit to the bathroom before asking someone to dance? Many people approach conversation in the spirit of being thoroughly prepared, pinning their confidence on studied subjects of conversation and planned lines of inquiry. A man who had reached the top of his profession told me once, to my surprise, that he often prepared conversational topics before meeting people so that he wouldn't be left hanging without something topical or interesting to say. Control has a lot going for it. You avoid unwelcome surprises and the unpleasant, chaotic feeling that you're no longer master of yourself. Life constantly demands an instant response. A tiger wanders up to our cave. Hide, run, attack, freeze, quick, choose. An employee is underperforming. Talk to him, show him a new way, sack him. Decisions, decisions. We don't feel quick enough on our feet. It's so much more comfortable to have a ready answer. But does it work in conversation? Conventional conversational skills. The instinct to control responses in conversation is usually based on the good intention of responding well. But with control, we never get beyond a general competence in communication. The deeper possibilities of conversation just don't happen. Most coaching in the art of conversation follows the control method. If you doubt your conversational skills and seek help from experts or books, you will probably be assisted to become more articulate. You'll work at your use of language and study to get accent and inflection right. You'll practice to make your sentences flow, and you'll learn anecdotes to have ready to call upon. You'll buff up your opinions and hone your arguments. You'll become skillful in the arts of oratory and debate, and also in small talk with its polite balance of question and answer. You'll learn how to put expression into your voice so that you sound interested, spontaneous even. Learned spontaneity. Even such a practiced and fluent communicator as Sir Winston Churchill used to spend enormous time and effort practicing and learning to sound spontaneous in his public speeches. His great friend F.E. Smith jibed that Winston spent the best years of his life preparing impromptu remarks. Calculation. More of us than would admit to it go into conversation at least some of the time with a calculation.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.